वेलकम स्लाइड में। Okay, so good morning everybody, and sorry for the slight delay in the beginning. We had technical glitches this morning. So good morning and welcome everyone. Welcome everyone for the day 5 and the final day of our faculty development program. So we just left with one scientific lecture for today. That will be on 3D modeling using NMR data. Resolving the structures of biomacromolecules is a crucial and fundamental to structural biology that assists drug development and discovery. High field and multidimensional NMR provides useful means for studying the detailed structure and dynamics of micromolecules in solution where they most likely exist in their native conformation. This provides an access to very important information on macromolecular flexibility, folding, their interactions with biological substrates and drug molecules. Three-dimensional structures provide important insights to understand the macromolecular mechanisms behind the cellular processes that help us design drugs. With the recent developments in the field of X-ray crystallography, multidimensional NMR techniques, computational chemistry, big data analytics, identification of new targets and developing new drugs are becoming simpler and more accessible than ever before. This session will provide us an insight, excellent insight into how to develop 3D models using NMR data. With this, I would welcome Dr. Vaishali Sirsat, who's an associate professor and the head of the Department of Pharmaceutical Analysis of Bombay College of Pharmacy, to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Evan Scutino.
Thank you, Dr. Elvis. Thank you, Dr. Elvis. So good morning, one and all present here for the, I think it's the day 5 and the session 13 that we'll be seeing today. And we have today with us Professor Evan Scutino, who actually needs no introduction, and I'm sure all of you will agree with this. So Professor Evan Scutino, in fact, it's my honor and pleasure to introduce you, though I know that you formally don't need any introduction and a very well-known personality in the field of pharmacy, in the field of I would say, pharmaceutical chemistry. So Professor Evan Scutino superannuated in January 2021 as the professor of the pharmaceutical chemistry at Bombay College of Pharmacy, where he was associated for 34 years. After earning a bachelor's degree in chemistry from Parle College, University of Mumbai in 1981, he went to pursue his MSc and MSc Tech from the University Department of Chemical Technology, currently known as the Institute of Chemical Technology, at the University of Mumbai in 1986. He completed his PhD in pharmaceutical chemistry under the able guidance of Professor V.M. Kulkarni at Bombay College of Pharmacy in 1989. Professor Scutino has published close to 180 papers with subject areas covering NMR studies on peptides, quantum chemical calculations, drug design techniques, and synthetic efforts to develop better anti-infective agents. His achievements have been recognized pan-India and also at the international level. It is impossible to mention his every single accomplishment, as there are many a lot. Professor Scutino has an active PCT for anti-tubercular agent acting against the dormant stage of Mycobacterium, filed over a dozen countries. He has supervised more than 48 master's students and has mentored 22 PhD students. Professor Scutino's interest lies in the elucidation of peptide protein structures using 1D, 2D NMR techniques, strategic design of anti-infective agents using computer-assisted tools, understanding drug resistance using computer simulations. Since 2008, his group has focused their efforts on developing new QSAR formalisms with emphasis on understanding the molecular property distribution over atoms that make up a molecule. Thank you so much, Professor Coutinho, for bestowing us with your presence today. And without much ado, I now request Professor Coutinho to take over and enrich the participants with your talk on building 3D models using NMR data. So over to you, Professor Coutinho.
Thank you, Dr. Vaishali, for that nice introduction. Am I audible to everybody?
Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vaishali, for that introduction. And thank you, Elvis, for that nice introduction on what NMR does and its role today in drug design and drug discovery. Okay, so let me start sharing my presentation. Is my slide visible? Can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, can you just, sorry to interrupt, can you just minimize the small masking thing on the right-hand side of the screen?
Yes.
Yes, sir, perfect.
Thank you, Elvis. Okay, so my talk is actually a follow-up on what Professor Hosur talked on Wednesday. He gave an excellent talk on NMR, starting from right from the basic and covered the advances. My talk will be how to use that NMR data to model structures. Okay, so if you want to build the 3D structure of any molecule, you need to completely define all the 3N-6 degrees of freedom, where N is the number of atoms in your molecule, or for linear molecules, the number of degrees of freedom that need to be specified is 3N-5. So if you have a molecule with about 100 atoms, the number of degrees of freedom work out to 3 into 100, that is 300 minus 6, which is 194 or 195, depending upon linear or non-linear molecules out here. Okay, so you need this extensive amount of knowledge about the degrees of freedom in order to completely build the 3D structure of a molecule. Now, those of you who are wondering, what is this degrees of freedom? The degrees of freedom are, for example, the bond length, the bond angles, the dihedral angles, okay, and all the information about non-bonded atoms, atoms which are in a 1,5, 1,6, and 1,7 relationship with each other. So you begin to see that you need a tremendous amount of data in order to be able to build the three-dimensional structure of any molecule. Now, when you look at a protein, and even if it's a small size protein, about 500 or 600 atoms, which is really a very small protein, a small enzyme, and you multiply that with 3N, 1,500 or 1,800 and minus 6. Now, that is very negligible, that minus 6. You think about the number of degrees of freedom that you need in order to build the complete structure of a protein molecule. Now, when we are trying to use NMR data, as Dr. Elvis has said, that NMR is one technique that can actually give us biologically relevant conformations. Conformations that are very physiologically relevant and very appropriate for drug design and drug discovery. But the problem with NMR, as you must have heard in Professor Hosur's lecture, that it is a very insensitive technique. And very sadly, that NMR cannot give you all the 3N minus 6 degrees of freedom. Whatever level of sophistication you may have, okay, for example, you may record multi-nuclear NMR, and in the case of proteins, it may be the 15N NMR, the 13C NMR, and you may even go to the extent of deuterium labeling your protein molecule. You can do 2D NMR. I'm talking about D, which is deuterium, the isotope of hydrogen. Whatever level of sophistication you can do, or you can go on to 3D NMR and 4D NMR and 5D NMR, in spite of all this sophistication, it is impossible to be able to get all the 3N minus 6 degrees of freedom by NMR. For example, NMR does not give us bond lengths, any information about the bond lengths in the molecule. What is the CC bond length? What is the carbon-nitrogen bond length? What is the carbon-oxygen bond length? Or even the carbon-hydrogen bond length. It's not available from NMR very easily. All the angles, for example, the carbon-carbon angles, carbon-carbon-nitrogen angles, carbon-carbon-oxygen angles. We cannot get all this information, the angles. As I said, that the degrees of freedom, one of the degrees of freedom is the angles. That cannot be extracted by any NMR experiment. Whatever you do, you may do labeling, okay, multi-nuclear NMR, you may do multi-dimensional NMR, but this information cannot be extracted from extra from NMR. So NMR data is sparse and available for only a fraction of the degrees of freedom out there. To the best, you may be able to get about 20 to 25% of the degrees of freedom. So by NMR, almost a large fraction of the degrees of freedom is actually absent, is missing. Okay? So what do we do? With the sparse NMR data, with very little information about the molecule, how do we go about building structures from NMR data? And I, as Elvis said, and I keep iterating that, NMR structures are very, very useful because I can record NMR in situations very close to the biological situations at physiological conditions. So it is very biologically relevant. The structures that we obtain by NMR are very biologically relevant. Now, this in by no means tries to belittle X-ray crystallography. I think you also heard a wonderful talk by Professor Verma about X-ray crystallography. X-ray crystallography is able to define all the 3N minus 6 degrees of freedom. So you are able to very explicitly pinpoint every atom in space. Of course, that depends upon the resolution at which your NMR, at which your IR has been recorded. Just 1 minute. Jos, I'm in a lecture. I'll call you later.
Okay.
So X-ray data can actually, you know, give you all the degrees of freedom, and as I said, you can precisely locate where each and every atom is in space. Okay, of course, it is limited to only the heavy atoms because the locations of hydrogens in your molecules need to be recorded by neutron diffraction, and that is not very easily. But that is not a big problem. Okay, that is not a big problem. So I actually stand a little bit corrected in saying that you can actually define all the degrees of freedom, even the positions of the hydrogen atom. That is if you have neutron diffraction data. In normal X-ray data, actually you can locate very explicitly, depending upon the resolution, you can locate the positions of the heavy atoms, the carbons, the nitrogens, the oxygens, etc. There are some little drawbacks in X-ray crystallography, but I won't talk about that. But X-ray crystallography looks at a structure that is frozen in time. You do not know about the dynamics. And dynamics is very, very important to know because you know that structures are not static in solution. Okay, your structures in solution, whether it's a protein structure or a DNA structure or a small molecule structure, they are basically tumbling. Okay, they're moving between different low energy states. And that information is actually related to the biological outcome of these molecules. The way the molecules modulate receptors and produces a pharmacological action is actually depend upon this dynamical behavior. And sadly, in X-ray crystallography, that dynamical behavior is actually missing. You get a structure that is static in time or frozen in time. Of course, there is a biological relevance to that structure. And also you notice that the structure obtained by X-ray crystallography is actually in a solid state. Now, that does not take away the, you know, the value and the significance of X-ray crystallographic structure, but NMR has, because it is recorded under biological conditions, we are very excited with NMR structures because we can closely relate it to physiological conditions and draw very meaningful interpretations about the structures of molecules and their biological activity out here. So with this drawback that NMR cannot give us explicitly all the degrees of freedom, so then how do we model structures by NMR? And therefore, molecular modeling plays a very central force. Okay, modeling is used in conjunction with NMR data to build and to refine the structure via a central force field. Now, what is a force field? I will talk about what is a force field a little later on. Before that, let me remind you of what Professor Hosu talked about NMR. When we record an NMR experiment, okay, depending upon the type of the experiment that we do and depending upon the dimension of the experiment that we do, we can get this five types of data from an NMR experiment. We can extract coupling constants, okay? The 3J coupling constants, that is the coupling constants basically between atoms which are separated by three bonds. So it is called the 3JHH coupling constants. You can extract quite a lot of coupling constants from NMR experiments. And I know that Professor Hosur has covered all of these important experiments, how you can extract coupling constants. Coupling constants in a very simplistic way are also visible in 1D NMR. You know the splitting patterns, doublets, triplets, quadruplets, etc. And from there, we can extract the coupling constants. However, when we look at protein data, you know that the 1D NMR data, you know, is so complex, so complicated. There are so much of overlapping lines that it becomes impossible to extract coupling constants from 1D data for large molecules out here because there's a considerable overlap of the resonance out here. And therefore, we need to devise a completely different set of experiments, you know, to record coupling constants. Professor Hosur must have talked about the J-resolved spectroscopy. The J-resolved spectroscopy is one technique which helps us to extract coupling constants in 2D NMR data. The next type of data that we can obtain by NMR is the nuclear Overhauser effect. You know that when two protons or any two nuclei, NMR active nuclei, are close by in space, then when you irradiate let's talk about protons. Okay, two protons which are close by in space, and by meaning close by in space, what do I mean by close by in space? At a distance of about 5 or 6 angstroms, then when I irradiate one proton, what happens is I disturb the population distributions of these spin systems. Okay, and when we disturb the population distributions of these systems by irradiating one of the protons, what happens is that relaxation processes kick in order to bring back the equilibrium distribution of these populations out here. So there are this T0 processes and this T2 processes, okay, which actually kick in order to restore this population distributions. And during this restoration of this population distribution, what happens to it? The other proton, which has not been irradiated, to that proton, which is close by in space, as an enhancement in a signal. So sometimes you begin to see an enhancement or a decrease in its signal intensity. And that is called as the nuclear Overhauser effect. So when you see an enhancement in the signal intensity, it is called as a positive NOE, or when you look at a decrease in the signal intensity, it's called as a negative NOE. And depending upon whether you get a positive or a negative, it all depends upon this relaxation, these two relaxation processes, which are working in order to restore the population's distributions that have been disturbed when we irradiated that second proton. Okay. So whether it's the T0 or the T2 processes depends upon how these two processes are working, and they will give us a positive NOE or a negative NOE. So the nuclear Oberhauser effect is a very important experiment because it actually tells us how a molecule folds, how atoms come close together in space. Okay, that gives us a very important conformation information. So the conformation, the overall three-dimensional structure can be obtained from coupling constants. I will talk about that later, and from this nuclear Oberhauser effect. Then we have these dipolar couplings. Okay, you know what are dipoles? You know, a monopoles and a dipole. A dipole is nothing but a separation between two, a positive and a negative charge. When you look at any structure, be it a small molecule structure or a macromolecular structure, there are numerous, there are myriads of dipoles in these structures. For example, the CO bond, the carbonyl bond in peptides, is a dipole. The NH bond is a dipole, okay, with the positive end of the dipole on the nitrogen, on the hydrogen, and the negative end of the dipole is basically on your nitrogen. So you have this numerous dipoles, and then you have this dipole-dipole interactions which take place. And then you can use very special experiments in order to extract this dipole couplings. Okay, this is not very common to do. They require very sophisticated experiments. And I think Professor Hosur may have covered some of these experimentations that help us to extract dipolar couplings. So dipolar couplings actually show you how these two dipoles are oriented together. So they actually depend upon the geometry and also the distance between these two dipoles. Then comes the information about chemical shifts. You all know about chemical shifts. All of you must have done some sort of NMR either in your undergraduate classes or in your postgraduate classes, and you know what the chemical shift is. For example, when we say that a particular proton resonates at 3.2 ppm, we know what exactly that means, 3.2 ppm. So chemical shifts also can be used in order to build the structure the structure of the molecules. Then hydrogen bonding. Okay, hydrogen bonding occurs between between two groups. Okay, acceptors and donors. Acceptors and donors. For example, the donor is an NH proton or an OH proton, and acceptors are typically electronegative atoms in your molecule, like oxygen atoms or halogen atoms, or even nitrogen atoms. So you have this donor-acceptor interaction that actually tells us about hydrogen-hydrogen bonding. You all know about intermolecular hydrogen bonding, how it helps to hold, you know, two different molecules together. You must have heard about intramolecular hydrogen bonding, which actually shows how the molecule folds to hydrogen bond upon itself. Okay, so all this hydrogen bonding gives us very crucial information about structure. So each one of these five elements, coupling constants, the NOE, the dipolar couplings, the chemical shifts, and the hydrogen bonding, if we can extract it from NMR experiments, okay, then we can use this data in order to model the structure of our molecule in solution. Now, let me just say a few words. Now, all of this information cannot be extracted in a simple experiment. Okay, sometimes one experiment may help us to get coupling constants and hydrogen bonding and chemical shifts. To get other information, for example, the nuclear Oberhauser effect, we'll have to do the 2D NOSY experiment, which Professor Hosur has presented to you, or the ROSY experiment, rotating frame NOEs in the rotating frame. We'll have to do these particular experiments in order to extract the nuclear Oberhauser effect, that is the distance between protons in space. Of course, and I said that also for dipolar couplings, there are special experiments that have to be conducted in order to extract dipolar couplings out there. Okay, so if we are able to do this, okay, if you are able to carry out all these different experiments and we can gather all this NMR data, now we can use this NMR data in order to build three-dimensional structures out here. But this NMR data, okay, cannot be used exactly as it is extracted from the NMR. This, it has to be converted into some other form, which will then be integrated in a molecular modeling program in order to extract the structure or order to build up the structure out there. Okay, so let's go back. Now, the structure of any molecule is dependent upon bond angles, bond lengths, dihedral angles, and the distance between the different protons out here. So what we need is basically bond lengths. As I told you, NMR cannot give us bond lengths, so this will be supplemented by molecular modeling programs. Bond angles, also NMR does not give us any information about bond angles. You will notice that the five parameters that I just showed you in my earlier slide has no information about bond angles. Yes. Dihedral angles, yes, dihedral angles, we can extract that, okay, from the 3J-HH coupling constants. Now, this dihedral angle actually must be extracted from the coupling constant. So you'll get this coupling constant, okay? You may get it about 7.2 hertz, 4.8 hertz, 12.1 hertz, depending upon how these two basically hydrogens are disposed in space. What is the angle between them? So from this coupling constant, 7.2 hertz, we must be able to extract the dihedral angle theta. And this is a relationship that actually shows you how the coupling constant is related to the dihedral angle theta. This is called as the Karplis relationship. You know, Martin Karplis won the Nobel Prize for his work basically on protein structure determination. Dr. Elvis is a big fan of Martin Karplis. Elvis, can you tell us when Martin Karplis got the Nobel Prize for his work? Which year was it?
Sir, in
2013 with Ariel Warshall, okay, and another person. Who was the third person who got the Nobel Prize with the Warshall and Karplis? Elvis? Hello? Elvis, you remember? Okay.
Sorry, sir.
You remember the third person who shared the Nobel Prize with Warshall and Karplis?
It is Michael Levitt.
So Michael Levitt, three of them shared the Nobel Prize for their tremendous work on actually structured data on protein NMR techniques, on protein NMR techniques. Okay, molecular modeling techniques to build protein structures. Okay. So as I was saying, the coupling constant is related to the dihedral angle theta, which is called as the Karplis relationship out here. Now, this is a complicated relationship. Okay, this is not a linear relationship. It is actually a non-linear relationship to the angle theta out there. Okay, so the cos square of the angle, okay, makes a certain contribution A to the 3J coupling constant. The cos of that angle contributes an amount B to the coupling constant, and there is a constant C. So for every type of dihedral angle, we have different values of A, B, and C out there. This can be obtained from literature. So for a particular type of dihedral angle, you will go to literature and you will plug in the values of A, B, and C. Okay. And on this side, you have the value of the coupling constant from which you have got it from NMR experiments. So let's say this is 7.2. So 7.2, it is equal to say some value of A into cos square theta plus some value of B into cos theta plus some value of C. As I was saying, A, B, and C are known. And all that I've got to do is to solve this equation for theta. Now it is very easy because there is only one known. 3J is known, A is known, B is known, and C is known. It seems very trivial that you will be able to get the angle of theta. No, But look very closely, there is a cos square relationship to the dihedral angle besides a linear relationship with the dihedral angle out here. So as a result of this, actually, there are four values of theta because of this cos square relationship. There are four values of theta which can actually satisfy this equation out here. And I will show you a little graph here. Look at this graph. So say, let's say the coupling constant is about 6 hertz. Okay, and I put 6 hertz in this equation and I get the values A, B and C for my dihedral angle from literature. And then I see that there are four values of theta. There is this theta one, which satisfies this equation. There is theta one, which is about 30 degrees, which can also satisfy this equation. There is theta two, which is about 130 degrees, which can satisfy this equation. There is theta 3, which is about 225 degrees, which can satisfy this equation. And there is theta 4, which is 340 degrees, which can satisfy this equation. So that there are four values of theta, which can actually satisfy this equation. So which is the exact value of theta? I need more information. So you begin to see now the trouble with NMR. NMR actually now needs to extract information from many other sources in order to build up a structure. And here is the first problem we encounter. In spite of knowing the coupling constant, we cannot uniquely get the value of theta, which gives us this dihedral, which gives us this J values out here. In fact, there are four values of theta which can actually satisfy this information. So which is the correct value of theta for that? I need some more information. And I'll say, how can I pinpoint which is the exact value of theta out there? Okay, now when we come down to, for example, protein structures, we have this 3JNH coupling constant. So what is this? Basically, it is the NH and CH coupling constant. The CH is the alpha carbon atom of my amino acid out there. So NH-CH coupling constant, the 3J coupling constant, I can easily extract from NMR experiments. As I said, a J resolved spectroscopy, which is a two-dimensional experiment. And then I can see these are the values for the 3J-NH coupling constant. A is 6.4. B is minus 1.4 and C is 1.9. So I can now put the value of this coupling constant, say it is 7.2, and I can solve for this value of phi. As I said, phi will not be uniquely identified. There are four values out there. Okay. So now, for example, let's look at some very characteristic values that give us some very defined structure. For example, if your coupling constant, if your 3JNH alpha is actually referring to the CH bond. So if my coupling constant between the NH proton and the C alpha H proton is about 3.9 hertz, one of the phi angles or the theta angles which satisfy this value is minus 57. And the value of minus 57 indicates that my protein or my peptide is going to adopt an alpha helical structure. Now, if my coupling constant is slightly higher at 4.2 hertz, then this corresponds to when I solve this equation, then one of the values of the phi values which satisfies this 4.2 hertz is this angle minus 60. And if I get this value minus 60, then I know that my protein has a 310 helical structure. Okay, so you begin to see now that the coupling constants actually are related to some very unique defined secondary structures for my molecule. So you're beginning to appreciate now what is the value of a coupling constant. The coupling constant directly relates to the two-dimensional structure or the secondary structure of my molecule. You know that the secondary structure of my molecule is essentially made up of alpha helices and beta sheets, which can be parallel beta sheets or anti-parallel beta sheets. There are other small elements of secondary structure, such as the beta turn and the gamma turn out there. I'm not going to talk about all of this, the beta turn and the gamma turn, because they also can be extracted depending upon the coupling constant. Okay, I just want to pause you. Are you able to see my cursor? Audience, can you see my cursor? Okay, I'm moving my cursor. Thank you so much. Now, if my coupling constant, the NHC alpha, is larger at 8.9 hertz, then this corresponds to a phi angle. Please appreciate that this is one of the phi angles. So one of the phi angles which come on solving this structure, basic when solving this equation, is minus 139. And if I get this angle of minus 139, I begin to interpret that my protein structure has an anti-parallel beta sheet. On the other hand, if my J value, if I extract a J value of 9.7 from my NMR experiments, then this corresponds to a phi value of minus 119 degrees. Okay, and this corresponds to a beta sheet. I want you to notice that the negative values of the phi angles. Okay, so you know that proteins and peptides, some of the most stable conformations along the basically the phi values. You know that there are two backbone angles in proteins called the phi and the psi angles. So when you must have done some lectures, your teacher must have taught you about protein structures, either in your biochemistry classes or sometime during some other classes, your teacher must have told you that in the backbone of the protein are these two angles, the phi and the psi angles. Of course, there is also the omega angle, which is the peptide bond. So you notice that, okay, the psi angle, I cannot extract information about what is the psi angle. The omega angle also, the peptide bond angle, the amide bond angle, that is also very difficult to extract by NMR. So all that we can get by NMR is actually only one dihedral angle in the backbone, and that is the phi value. Okay, nevertheless, even with this sparse bit of information, you begin to see the value of the coupling constant because it directly relates to the secondary structure of that molecule. Okay, so once we know what is the phi angle, okay, what are these phi angles, I can plug these phi angles into my molecular modeling program and generate a structure. More about that a little later on. Coming down to the nuclear Oberhauser effect. The nuclear Oberhauser effect is the richest source of structural information in NMR. And to extract this information, okay, the distances between the protons from NMR, the most common experiment that is done is the NOSI, the nuclear Oberhauser enhancement spectroscopy, or for small molecules, the ROSI is done, the rotating frame NOEs in the rotating frame. Why this is done? Why we need NOSI is mostly done for macromolecules, and for small molecules, a ROSI is done. Now, why this is done is because of the correlation times, the tumblings, etc., which I really do not have time to talk about. I hope Professor Hosur would have covered this out there. Okay, but you begin to see the nuclear Oberhauser effect, which is the enhancement in the signal of a particular proton when another proton which is close by in space to that proton is irradiated. This nuclear Oberhauser effect is actually a function of the inverse sixth power of the distance between the protons. Now, what does this mean? Let's take two proton pairs I and J, which are at a distance r. Okay, so now you see the nuclear Oberhauser effect between protons I and J, which are at a distance r, is dependent upon the 1 over the sixth power of this distance. That means we know 1 over sixth power means an inverse relationship to the sixth power of this distance. What does this mean? For example, when the distance between the proton pairs I and J double, the nuclear Oberhauser effect will almost go to zero because R raised to the power sixth. So you see that the NOE dies down very quickly when the distance between the proton pairs I and J grow large. And that is why I told you the nuclear Oberhauser effect is only discernible, can only be seen when my proton pairs I and J are at a distance of about 5 angstroms from each other. Now, you know why? It is because of this relationship, because of this inverse sixth power relationship upon the NOE. The NOE is written by the Greek term eta out there. Okay. Okay, so when the protons are about 7 or 8 angstroms in space from each other, when I and J protons are separated by a distance of 7 or 8 angstroms in each other, we don't see an NOE. An NOE cannot be recorded. It must be closer than 5 or 6 angstroms. Now, let's say now, if I can detect the NOE between proton pairs I and J and another pair K and N, then I have this very important relationship between the ratios of the NOE. So the NOE between the proton pairs I and J divided it by the NOE between the proton pair K and L is given by the 6th power of the distance between the proton pairs K and L divided it by the 6th power of the distance between the proton pairs I and J. Look very closely at this relationship, okay? So you have the NOE for I and J in the numerator on the left-hand side of this equation, and you have the distance between the proton pairs I and J on the denominator of the right-hand side of this equation. And the opposite is true, which is in the denominator here goes up in the numerator on the right-hand side because we have this inverse relationship out there. So what happens is, you know, if I have the NOE between two proton pairs, okay, whatever is the NOE that is between two proton pairs, I can relate them to the distances between these two proton pairs. Okay, so let's say that, okay, I know the distance between K and L. By some other technique, by some other method, I know this distance. So this distance K and L is known. How do we know this? We know this from maybe some prior information is known. I know K and L are separated from each other by about 3.4 angstrom. And this is very important. In order to solve this equation, okay, we need to have only one unknown. Okay, so let's say I have extracted NOEs between proton pairs I and J from an NMR experiment. I have extracted NOEs between proton pairs K and L from the NMR experiment, that the Nanozi experiment, and I know by some means, I know the distance between proton pairs K and L. So I know 1, 2, 3 things I know, and now I can extract the distance between proton pairs I and J because that is the only unknown. So you see the difficulty in this equation is that I need 3 bits of information. Nij, the NOE between proton pairs I and J, the NOEs between proton pairs K and L, which is not difficult from the NMR experiment, from the Nosy experiment, but I need to have some reference distance, at least for one of the proton pairs, whether it is K or L or I or J, I need to know their distance out there. And this is very important. When I know the distance of one of the proton pairs, I can then calculate the distance for the other proton pairs out here. Okay, so that is the crux of the how to use NOE in calculating distances between unknown distances between proton pairs. Okay, so I told you how the NOE is recorded, how the NOE information can help us to extract the exact distances between the proton pairs which are involved in the NOEs out here. Now, NOEs can be strong, can be intermediate or weak out here. So when protons I and J, or any two protons I and J, which are close by in space at a distance about 1.8 to 2.8 angstroms from each other, then we know that the NOE is very strong. When the distance is slightly larger between the proton pairs going up to 3.8 angstrom, then the NOE is an intermediate. So the intensity of the signal, what do I mean by strong, intermediate and weak NOE is the intensity of the signal. How strong is the intensity of the NOE, the enhancement, okay, or the decrease in the signal intensity? And when the proton pairs are at the maximum distance, the limit of the NOE detection, that is 5 angstrom, we see that the NOEs are very weak. Okay, so what we have information, we know the strength of the NOE. Okay, this is NMR experiments will give me, because I can see how strong is the signal intensity, how strong is the intensity prior to, before recording the NMR. but prior to before recording the NOSI experiment. Okay, so after I record the NOSI experiment, I will see the NOE signal, and I know that without the NOSI experiment, I also know the NMR signal of those particular protons. So from those things, I know whether the NOE is strong, intermediate, and weak. And from this information that I extract from my NMR, I know the distances between the protons, whether they are close by in space, or whether they are separated by 3.8 angstroms in space, or whether they are separated by 5 angstroms in space. So this is how you can relate the signal intensity to the distance between the protons out here. Please note that, okay, protons cannot approach to each other below a distance of 1.8 angstroms, because between 1.8 angstroms, what happens is their electron clouds will start to clash with each other, and it will get a very unstable structure. That is why you have this lower limit. No two protons can come basically below a distance of 1.8 angstroms from each other, because this is the limit of the van der Waals radius of the two proton. There will be a huge repulsion out here. Okay, so this is about the nuclear Oberhauser effect. As I told you, basically, okay, the dipolar couplings are not very easy to record. They need very special experimentation out there. Now, one thing about the dipolar couplings, in a normal NMR experiment, you don't see dipolar couplings. Okay, dipolar couplings are another. For example, all of you must have recorded a 1D NMR, and you must have seen that signals are normally split. You get doublets, you get triplets, or quadruplets, or pentuplets, etc., etc. That is because of the J couplings. Actually, the dipolar coupling should also be visible. Now, why don't you see dipolar couplings in your 1D NMR experiment, or even in most 2D NMR experiment? Is that because in the case of most molecules, which are freely tumbling in solution, the actually dipolar couplings go to zero. Okay. When you look at any two dipoles in your molecule, you know they are not in the same orientation with each other. The molecule, because it's tumbling, the dipoles, actually the angles between the dipoles keeps on fluctuating very rapidly. And as a result, because of this fluctuating angles between the dipoles, the dipole coupling constant actually goes to zero and doesn't become visible in your most NMR spectra. So in order to extract actually dipolar couplings, what we need to do is actually we need to prevent the molecule from tumbling, and from the dipolar couplings going to zero. How do we do this? In order to do this, people actually take your molecules and impregnate it in a lipid bilayer. When you impregnate your molecule, be it a protein or your small molecule or any sort of molecule, when you impregnate it in a bilayer, like such as a lipid bilayer, that prevents that peptide or that protein or that small molecule from tumbling. This in a bilayer, your molecule is held in a very rigid orientation. It is prevented from tumbling. And only in such situations, you can then extract your dipolar coupling. So now you understand why I said that dipolar couplings are not easy to extract. You need special conditions to extract dipolar couplings, and you need special type of experiments also in order to extract dipolar coupling. Dipolar couplings are visible in your solid state NMR. You also know that we can record NMR of actually crystal structures. Many of you must have recorded NMR of polymers, and you must have got some information about polymer structures, or et cetera, et cetera. So many of you make polymers, especially the pharmaceutics people, and they're able to extract actually information, okay, out of this. The dipolar coupling, they are visible okay. So dipolar couplings need very special experimentation and special conditions in order to extract it. But that is very useful. If you can do that, you get a lot of information about the structure. Chemical shifts, okay. So there is a direct correlation of chemical shift to three dimensional structures out here. Now, chemical shift is very easy to record. All of you, when you have taken a 1D NMR experiment, you must have said this proton resonates at 1.2 ppm. Okay, you must have said that the aromatic protons resonate at 7.2 ppm or 8.1 ppm. All that you were able. So that chemical shift information actually is very useful in order to be able to extract or build three-dimensional structures. Now, to use chemical shift data, this PPM data, in order to build three-dimensional structures is done through phenomenological theories or to empirical relationships. So people have established relationships how chemical shift information can be used to build structures through relationships. So there is some equation. I'm not writing down this equation, but there is some equation, just like the equation that I showed you for coupling constants and the dihedral angle. There is also a relationship that people have built, an equation that people have built between the three-dimensional structure and the chemical that is there. Now, when we come down to chemical shift, which chemical shifts are we referring to? Okay, it is not the proton chemical shifts. Actually, it is the C13 chemical shifts that are actually used in order to build three-dimensional structure out here. Okay, so we need to record 13C spectra. We need to record 13C spectra and extract the chemical shift of the 13C carbon atoms in order to build that structure. You know that the chemical shift of carbon atoms is much widespread compared to the chemical shift of protons. You know, protons have a chemical shift that spans from 0 to 15 ppm at the most. Okay, normal. So, the chemical shift is from 0 to 10, but you know, we can also go down depending upon the type of protons, especially if you have very acidic protons. Okay, it'll go down below 10 ppm. Okay, so the maximum limit that we have seen is about 15 ppm. In contrast, the 13C chemical shift almost spans from 0 ppm to more than 200 ppm out here. Okay, but however, what I want to say is that you must record a 13C spectrum, and from the 13C spectrum, you must extract the chemical shifts of all the carbon atoms that are there in your molecule, and use that chemical shifts through an equation in order to build the three-dimensional structure out there. Now comes down to the fifth amount of information out there. Okay, this is the hydrogen bonds. Now, how do we extract information about hydrogen bonds? Okay, so which are the atoms that enter into hydrogen bonds? These are the NH atoms and the OH atoms. These are the donor atoms that hydrogen bond to acceptor atoms. So what are acceptor atoms in my molecules? Electronegative atoms like oxygen atoms, like the oxygen of a carbonyl group, or the nitrogen atoms, okay, or even halogens which are there inside your molecule. These are the acceptor group. The donors are the NH and the OH. So how do I know that a particular NH proton in my molecule is hydrogen bonding? Is by recording what is called as a temperature dependent NMR. Okay, so what I do is I record NMR data at different temperatures, starting from room temperature, 297 Kelvin, I record the 1D spectrum, and I identify where the NH proton is, the chemical shift of the NH proton. Then I record another experiment at a temperature of 303 Kelvin. I jump up the temperature by 5 degrees, and I record a new 1D spectrum. Then for that same NH proton, I see where it has located. It will slightly shift depending upon whether it is hydrogen bonded, intramolecular hydrogen bonded, or intermolecular hydrogen bonding. This slight increase in the temperature will cause the chemical shift of the NH proton to slightly move upfield or downfield. I identify it and I record where it has shifted. Then I take another temperature experiment at 310, again identify that NH proton, that particular NH proton, and see its chemical shift, where it has moved. Okay, it is going to move definitely, whether it is intramolecular hydrogen bonded or whether it is this out there, the chemical shifts are going to vary. So I keep recording successive temperature dependent NMR experiments. I go right up to 323 Kelvin. Okay, now we have to be careful. I said 323 Kelvin. We have to be careful that at this temperature, my molecule doesn't degrade. Sometimes proteins may degrade at this 323 degrees. So then we need to go down slightly lower and stop at about 318 Kelvin at a temperature where the molecule doesn't degrade. So from all these temperature dependent NMR experiments, I record the chemical shift, and then I plot, okay, the change in the chemical shift with temperature. Okay, now what will happen is, If protons are intramolecular hydrogen bonding, then the change in chemical shift, the change in chemical shift with increasing temperature is very, very small because it is hydrogen bonded out there. However, if the molecule is not hydrogen bonded, it is exposed to the solvent at which the NMR has been conducted, or it is intermolecular hydrogen bonded or something like that, mostly when it is exposed to the solvent, then there is a very large change in the chemical shift. So depending upon the change in the chemical shift, I begin to deduce that these NH protons and these OH protons are hydrogen bonded, and these protons are not hydrogen bonded out here. So from this information, basically, I can then use in order to build my structures out here. Okay. The another thing of information we need to put into our molecular modeling program to build structures is chirality. Now, chirality cannot be obtained by NMR. NMR cannot give us chirality. Now, why we need to specify chirality when we are building three-dimensional structures? Because you know that especially molecules which have chiral structures, we want to preserve their chirality when we are building structures. Okay, you know that your peptides and your proteins, which are made up of amino acids, basically have the S configuration, or depending upon the R configuration, they are basically D amino acids. Okay, D and L amino acids, mostly they are L amino acids. Okay, D is very rare. We use only D amino acids when we want some very particular things in my peptide and protein structures. When I want to prevent degradation, okay, or some sort of things like that, then we put in your D amino acids. Mostly it is all the L amino acids out there. And you know the L amino acids, all of them except cysteine and methionine have the S configuration. And we want to preserve this configuration at the chiral carbon atoms, which is the C alpha carbon atom, in our modeling program out here. So this chirality needs to be introduced into our molecular modeling program in order to preserve the configurations of the chiral atoms in my molecular modeling during my molecular modeling program. I reiterate that chirality cannot be extracted by NMR, but has to be supplemented by this information out here. Okay. So here you begin to see now the principal sources of NMR data are out here. So I have torsion angles. This is the torsion angle that tells you how these atoms are actually related to each other in space. How this atom and this atom is related in space depends upon this torsion angle. So if I rotate around this torsion angle, then you see this atom and this atom will actually move away in space, and you'll get different values of this torsion angle. So you see now torsion angle relates to three-dimensional structures. The NOEs, okay, look at these two atoms. Let's regard them as hydrogens. Okay, the distance between them basically will give me an NOE. If they are far away from each other, then I do not see an NOE. If they are close by in space at a distance of less than 5 or 6 angstroms, I will see an NOE that may be strong, that may be weak, or that may be intermediate out here. Okay, then there is this dipolar couplings that I was talking to you about that actually tells you how dipoles are oriented from each other. Then there is this hydrogen bonding distances. Okay, let's say this is a proton which is hydrogen bonded to this atom. Okay, then this information I can use in order to build three-dimensional structure. So all this information, most of it which can be extracted from NMR experiments, can be used to build the three-dimensional structure of my molecules out there. Okay, so now what is the method that I use with this sort of information that I have extracted from NMR in order to build the three-dimensional structures? I have two techniques which are available to me in order to build the three-dimensional structures. And these techniques are basically molecular dynamic simulations and distance geometry. So I will just talk a little bit about how does molecular dynamics help us in order to build three-dimensional structures. I do not think I have time to talk about distance geometry, how distance geometry is used in order to build three-dimensional structures out here. Okay, I say this again, that molecular dynamic simulation will use NMR data. I repeat, molecular dynamic simulation will use NMR data along with other supplementary information which is not available from my NMR experiments in order to build three-dimensional structures. Some other techniques which can also be used to build three-dimensional structures are energy minimization techniques, Monte Carlo simulated annealing, and genetic algorithms out here. Okay, I don't have time to talk about these methods, how they are used in order to build three-dimensional structures. I will only talk about molecular dynamics simulations out here. Okay, so Dr. Elvis?
Yes,
sir. Elvis, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, can we take just a short 5 minutes break? I just need to charge back my laptop and my connectivity, my dongle. Okay?
Yes, sir. Definitely, we can take a 5 minute break.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Shall we resume?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so let's look at molecular dynamic simulations. Okay, what is molecular dynamic simulations all about? Okay, molecular dynamics simulation involves solving Newton's equations of motions. Okay, so Newton's equations of motions basically are related to helping us to predict the positions of objects after a certain lapse of times if we know some information. Okay, for example, at point time t, if I have some information about my system, for example, I know where my system is in space, that means I know the coordinates of my system. What do I mean by the coordinates of my system? For each and every particle in my system, for each and every thing that makes up my system, okay, in case of our molecules, it is the particles are referred to as the atoms. If I know where the atoms are in space, the x, y, and z coordinates of every atom in space, and if I know the velocity of the atoms, and if I know the acceleration for the atoms, then Newton's equations of motions helps me to use this information about the positions of the atoms, the velocity of the atoms, and the acceleration of the atoms to calculate new positions where every atom will move after a certain time t. So I solve Newton's equations of motions basically, which is nothing but force is equal to mass into acceleration. And from this Newton's equations, which are basically solved, I can get new positions in time. I can show how my system is actually evolving in time. Okay, where the atoms are moving in space. So why the atoms are moving in space? Because every atom has a force that is being experienced. Every other atom actually, puts a certain amount of force on another atom. Every atom experiences a certain force because of the neighboring atoms. You know, our molecules are a system of interacting particles. All the particles are actually interacting with each other. There are forces, okay? There are these Van der Waals forces. There are these Coulombic forces. These are electrostatic forces which each atom exerts upon each other. These forces could be attractive forces. These forces could be repulsive forces. So every atom in my molecule is under some severe force. And because of this, the atoms are moving out in space in order sort of to occupy positions where they are less interacting from each other. Okay, so that is the whole goal in why molecules are moving about, because of this huge amount because of these forces that the atoms are experiencing. Now, I'm not talking about tumbling motions and translation motions, which are related to the Brownian motion. I'm talking about this internal forces that atom experience with each other. Even when atoms are bonded together, two atoms which are bonded together, which are joined together by a bond, even experience a certain force. Atoms which are joined together by an angle, three atoms which are joined together by an angle, there is a force that is acting on all of these three, on these three atoms. Okay, then atoms which are joined together by a dihedral angle, four atoms which are joined together in a dihedral angle, there is a force exerting on all these four atoms. Then there is this Van der Waals interactions between the different atoms. There is this Coulombic interactions between these atoms. And because of this tremendous forces that each atom is, actually the atoms are actually moving about in space. And they're moving about in space directed by the force that is exerted on each other. So you know that force is equal to mass into acceleration. And if I can pinpoint where these atoms are, where these forces are on each atom, then I can actually get new positions in time. And how do I get that? By simply solving Newton's equations of motion. Okay. So these forces cause the molecule to actually adopt different conformations, okay? Different conformations, and even the momenta changes, okay? Momenta is nothing but another expression for the velocity. The momentum changes so that molecules actually now begin to explore different aspects of the phase space. or the configurations plays out here. Okay, now there is another environmental factor that actually dictates about these forces and the motion. There is the temperature and the pressure. Okay, so that what a temperature affects the kinetic velocity of this the kinetic energy of these molecules. The kinetic energy basically nothing but is related to the velocity. Okay, you know this, and the pressure also affects this motion of the atoms out here. So in order to explicitly account for how these motions, okay, or these movements are there for each atom in space, we need to account for the temperature effects and the pressure effects also. So both of these can nicely be taken into account during an MD simulation out here. So an MD simulation actually is very comprehensive. It actually takes into account both the potential energy of the system and the kinetic energy of the system, which is actually driving these equations of motions, okay, and how the conformation is actually changing. All these effects can be taken in a molecular dynamics simulations out here. Now, those of you who are a little bit inclined to what are these equations that need to be solved in order to record new positions with time, here are these equations. Force is equal to mass into acceleration. So every atom I experiences a certain force which is related to the mass of the atom and the acceleration of the atom out here. Okay, the force on the atom is actually obtained by the first differential of the energy of your system with respect to the particular position of my atom. So the force on my particular atom I is nothing but the first derivative of the energy of the system with respect to the position or the coordinates of that particular atom. So where that atom is in space, the x, y, and z coordinates of that space, if I differentiate the energy with respect to the coordinates of that particular atom, I get the force. So force can very easily be coordinate because the energy for the system, I have a very explicit equation that helps me to calculate the energy for the atom. And I know where my atoms are in space at any given point in time. So I know the forces that each atom experiences. Then on the right hand side is the acceleration of the atoms. So the acceleration of the atoms is given by the second derivative of the position of the atoms with respect to time. Accelerations are a function of time. Okay, forces are only dependent upon structure. So look at this. Look at where my cursor is moving. Okay, the forces are dependent upon the positions of the atom in space, okay, and as derivatized with respect to the energy of that particular structure with that particular position in space. However, the accelerations are a function of time. Okay, you know that the first derivative of position with time is velocity, and the first derivative of the velocity with respect to time is acceleration. All of you know these things. So what it turns out that the second derivative of the position with respect to time is actually the positions out here. So now I want you to concentrate very, very carefully out here. So look at this equation. So when I look at this equation, there is an energy term, there is a position term. Okay, there are two position terms and there is a time term out here. Okay, so this is how Newton's equations of motions are used. Okay, so this is a second order differential equation with respect to positions and times, and a first order differential with respect to the energy and the positions out here. So this is a quite complicated differential equation that must be solved. Okay, so if I can solve this differential equation. Now you all must have done some course in mathematics, either in your 12th standard or maybe even in your BPharm levels or sometime during your study. And you know that differential equations are solved by actually integrating the differential equations out here. So very obviously we have to integrate these differential equations in order to find the solution. What is the solution? The solution is actually an equation which actually tells us how the different elements in this equation or how the different variables in this equation are related to each other. So I repeat, integrating this differential equation, this is nothing but your Newton's equations of motions, will get me a new equation which actually relates positions with respect to time. Okay, now that is not a simple equation. It's quite a complicated. It's quite a complicated equation, an equation which will give me on one side, which will get me positions, and on the other side will actually get me the time variable. So these two variables which actually can be extracted from this from integration of this differential equation. So in other sense, I can, by solving the second order differential equations, tells me how atoms, okay, move about in space, how their coordinates ri change with time. That is what I get by solving the second order differential equation. Now, I told you that you must have learned that solving differential equations is by integration. However, we cannot use analytical integration in order to solve this differential equation. That is, to get a relationship of positions with time, we cannot do this for this Newton's equations of motions, because these Newton's equations of motions are very tightly coupled. Please note that there is one equation for every atom. And note that, for example, if I have 500 atoms in my molecule, then I have 500 of these equations. Okay, I have 500 of these equations. 500 of these equations, because this equation is very specific for every atom. I stands for a particular atom in my system. So I have 500 equations. So if I have 1,000 atoms, I have this 1,000 equations. Now the problem with this 1,000 equations. So even if you have three atoms in your system, there are these three equations. Now the problem with all of these equations, whether it is three, whether it is 100, whether it is 500, or whether it is 10,000, okay, 10,000, don't get too stunned by it, because there are some proteins which are as large as have more than 10,000 atoms, and we are not surprised at that. When I have this large number of differential equations, they all coupled together. They're tightly integrated to each other. The problem with this coupled differential equation is that I cannot solve first equation without getting an answer from the second equation. And the problem is I cannot get an answer for the second equation without solving the first equation. That is meaning of how these equations are actually coupled to each other. They're all integrated and tied up with each other. They are all asking for information. In order to solve one particular information, it is asking me, give me that information about that equation. And that equation is saying, I need information from this equation. So they're all tightly coupled with each other. And as a result of this, we cannot solve Newton's equations of motions analytically. So we must use what are called as numerical methods for solving Newton's equations of motion out here. Okay, to solve this Newton's equation of motion, there are these numerical methods which have been devised. Okay, there are very simple methods called as the Fermi algorithms, the Runge-Kutta methods, the Beeman methods. Okay, all of these people have actually written equations how to get new positions of the atoms as a function of time without integrating these equations explicitly or analytically. Okay, all of these equations, whether it is the Fermi equations, whether it is the Bob and Beeman equations, whether it is the Runge-Kutta methods, all of these equations are dependent upon this Taylor expansions. Okay, so the Taylor expansions tells you that this one important thing I want you to appreciate. It tells you that the position of a particular atom after some time has passed is dependent upon the position of the atom at particular time t. Say I am now at point zero in my time, and after a certain lapse of time, okay, now let's for argument say that this lapse of time is in seconds. Okay, now in the molecular system it is not seconds, but let's say for a macromolecular object in the macroscopic world, I'm looking for a lapse of time after some few seconds, and I want to solve where my atom goes after some few seconds. So it is asking me, you tell me now where your atom is, and I will tell you. So RT is, you tell me now where your atom is, and I will tell you after a few seconds where your new atom will be. This information can only be got from the present position. To the present position, I will add the velocity. dr by dt is the velocity of the atom, multiplied it by that time lapse, this 1 second, plus the acceleration. This is the second derivative of position with time. As I told you earlier, this is the acceleration, and multiplied it by the time step square. So it is very simple. If I know where my atom is at particular point in time, I add the velocity and the time for which I want to solve this equation. I add the accelerations and I add the time, the square of the time to it, and then I can get new positions in time. Okay, so all of this solving those Newton's equations of motions, you saw this Newton's equations of motion actually are solved through this Taylor series out here. Now, this expression that you see, that I can get new positions after a certain lapse of times from the present positions and adding the velocity and adding the acceleration, is written in terms of some linear equations out here. Okay, so here is basically some linear equations out here. So look at this equation. Okay, this equation is telling me, okay, if I want to know the position of any atoms after a lapse of time, what I need to add is, I know where is it in a particular lapse of time. I need to add the velocity, okay, the how the velocity changes after a certain lapse of time, and how the velocity changes after a certain lapse of time is got from equation number one. It tells me what was the previous velocity. To the previous velocity, I add the acceleration and I get the velocity. So this part of the equation comes from here. Okay. Now, to get this velocity, which is needed in this equation, in the second equation, I need the accelerations. And to get the acceleration comes from this equation. The acceleration is nothing but the derivative of the energy with respect to that position atoms out here. So if I use these three equations, I actually can now get how atoms are moving with respect to time. So as time passes, how atoms are actually moving in space and acquiring new positions in space. So what is driving the atoms to new positions in space is essentially the forces, and the forces are related to the accelerations, as you saw in this equation. Okay, is the forces that every atoms are experience because of the other atoms that are surrounding it, and these forces come arise because of the accelerations, okay, as shown by this equation, and these accelerations move the atoms to new positions, to the new positions in space out here. Okay, so I have to solve Newton's equations of motions in order to generate three-dimensional structure. So you all must be wondering now, where am I getting? I started with NMR data and I suddenly switched on to molecular dynamic simulations out here. Okay, now, but the most important thing is why I need to talk to you all about out here. Look at this. I told you that we need this energy E, and I need to differentiate the energy of my structure with respect to the position of a particular atom. I need this information to get acceleration. Only when I get this information about acceleration, I can put in this equation, and then I can solve for velocity, and I can use this velocity here and then solve for new positions with time. So you saw this all this relationships that are important. Then the first thing comes in, how do I get this term? The first derivative of the energy with respect to the positions of the atom. So where is the energy equation? So here is the energy equation. So this is how the energy of my system is calculated. Please don't get lost. I'm going to soon come about how to use NMR data in this molecular dynamic simulations, how NMR data is used in molecular dynamic simulation in order to generate NMR structure. I'm not lost. I'm not deviated. But I need to talk about a little bit about molecular dynamics simulation. So here is the energy for the system. Okay, so here is what is called as a force field. Okay, this is how the energy for any system is calculated by a molecular mechanics force field. The energy for the system comes from equations which tell you how the energy changes with bonds, how the energy changes with angles, how the energy changes with dihedral angles, how the energy changes with van der Waals relationships, how the energy changes with Coulombic interactions. So you begin to see the energy of the system is dependent upon bond energy, angle energy, torsion energy, van der Waals energy, and Coulombic energy and energy out here. So this is the energy expression that I was talking to you about out here. Now, I can differentiate this energy equation for my system with respect to the positions of the atoms out here. Now, don't worry about all that complexities. That is very easily done. How to differentiate this energy with respect to the position of every atom in space? That can very easily that can very easily be done. So pictorially, if you wanted to look about how the energy for a molecule is actually is this equation, I'm showing you pictorially, the energy for a molecule depends upon the energy for stretching a bond, depends upon the energy for stretching every angle in my molecule. The energy for a molecule is dependent upon the energy that is needed to rotate about torsion angles. Okay, the energy that is needed for basically for van der Waals interactions and for Coulombic interactions out here. So these are this term I've shown you pictorially. This is the van der Waals interactions, which is dependent upon basically how atoms are in space. Okay, and then Coulombic energy, you can see here, is dependent upon the charges on the atoms. Then there are the dihedral angles here, okay? The dihedral angles which dictate the energy. Then the bond angles, bond energy, which is shown here, and the angle energy in here. So this is a pictorial representation of this complicated mathematical equation for the energy for the system. Don't bother. It is easy to solve. It looks a little complicated. It looks a little daunting, this equation out here, but it is very easy to solve if I have some information about my system out here. Okay, so once I have this, I can actually now get this. I can differentiate the energy for my system using that equation with respect to that. So this is known, acceleration is known. I put the acceleration out here. I know previous velocities. I can calculate the velocities after a certain lapse of time. I put this here, and if I know for present positions, I can calculate new positions with time out here. Now, where am I deviating now? Okay, so let me... let me go out. Okay, so let's look at this equation. Okay, this equation. Now, what do I need to do? In this energy equation, I will supplement some more information. So what I'm going to do in this energy equation, I'm going to add some terms that are related to all my NMR information. Okay, so all my NMR information, this five NMR information, coupling constants, nuclear Overhauser effect, dipolar couplings, chemical shift, and hydrogen bonding, and the chirality, all this information, I will convert it into some form of equations and use those five NMR equations in new terms out here. So I supplement this bones, bare bones energy term of my molecule, which is also sufficient to determine a structure. I will supplement it with NMR equation by writing some more NMR equation. And now here comes a very comprehensive energy equation. Let me see if I have this comprehensive energy equation out for you. It looks very complicated. Okay, so let me not write this complicated and daunt you with this energy equation. Okay, it looks very, very daunting. Just don't bother. Close your eyes if you don't want to look at mathematic equations. It's a daunting equation out here. But I will show you what this NMR equation is all about. Okay, so the first term now I have a new energy equation. What is this new energy equation? This new energy equation is written with this original information supplemented with information from NMR. Okay, so what is that new energy equation? The new energy equation, which I write it as the E total, is supplemented with all those information that I showed you here, this information, plus I add basically information about my NOEs. So those NOEs, which I have extracted as distances, I have to convert those distances into an energy equation. Okay, I will show you how to do that a little bit. The dihedral angles that I determined, the 3J coupling constants, which I determined, that information has got to be converted in another energy equation, which I will show you very shortly. Okay. The hydrogen bonding information which I got has to be converted into another energy equation and added here. the chirality information, which is not coming from NMR, but which is coming from standard information, I will convert that chirality information into another equation and add it here. So now you see, I have a very comprehensive energy equation that is taking information for, about my NOEs, about my dihedral angles, about my hydrogen bonding. You can add even your energy for the dipolar couplings. If you have all of the, all your NMR data must be converted into some energy expressions into and added to this total energy for the system out here. Now, this is an energy equation which now is then used in your molecular dynamics simulations in order to solve this Newton's equations of motion. So now let's go back to the Newton's equations of motions and just show you for last time what this. So this energy, now you know, is not only the bond energy, the angle energy, it includes dihedral information energy, it uses NOE energy information, it uses dipolar couplings information, it uses hydrogen bonding information. So this is a comprehensive information about the system out here, which I can now use in order to generate my NMR structure. Okay, so those of you who are wondering how NMR information is converted into an energy equation out here. So let me show you one relationship. Okay, let me show you one. How NOE information, okay? How and what is NOE information? NOE information is nothing but a distance between two protons. And that distance between the two protons, I and J, can be 3.4 angstroms. Now, this distance must be converted into an energy equation. And look here. Okay, so the energy equation is written as follows. The energy equation is written to as some constant K, which is the constant, the force constant for the NOEs, into a expression for the distances. So dij is the distance that was extracted from my NOEs, the distance between my protons I and J. Okay, now this energy equation actually has different formats. It has four formats. Okay, the first format is basically a format which uses a harmonic relationship. And this harmonic relationship is when L, the lower bound between the atoms I and J, okay, when my distance is less than the lower bound, then I use this form of my equation. Okay, the equation is equal to K NOE into zero is another form of the equation when I see that my distance is between the lower bound and the upper bound out here. So now what is the lower bound? Remember that I told you that atoms cannot come closer than basically a certain distance out here. Okay, so when my upper bound is less than my distance out here, I will use this form of my relationship out here. And no, what I'm trying to say is these are the ways that distances are converted into energy expressions out here. Now all these energy expressions are actually shown by this complicated curves. And I know it is very, very daunting for you, but all that I want to tell you is NMR data, whatever NMR data, must be converted into an energy expression, and that energy expression will be basically plugged in into the standard energy expression out here. So now you're getting the relationship. Okay, I have a standard energy expression for every molecule. I supplement that standard energy expression with NMR information out here through energy expressions out here, and now I can use this relationship in order to solve for the structures for my molecule out here. I know there are complicated equations. I will not go into it. Okay, so here is basically how chirality is converted. Information about chirality. This is the equation for converting chirality information into the chirality equation. Yeah, the chirality equation out here. So H bonding, I'll just throw for you H bonding. Okay, how, see, here is this equation, little complicated. Here is the equation how dihedral angles are actually converted into the energy expression for the dihedral angles out here. Now these equations are a little complicated and it will take time in order to express what is this, what are these equations. Don't bother too much about it. All that I want to tell you is the take home thing is that NMR information is being used in simulating, in molecular dynamics simulations, to simulate an NMR relevant structure out here. Okay, so there are different types of molecular dynamics simulations that are actually I can use a very simple molecular dynamics simulations in order to generate new structures. I can use complicated MD simulations, which is called as simulated annealing. Okay, simulated annealing. In simulated annealing, what we try to do is basically we heat the molecule to a very high temperature, okay, and then bring down the temperature successively in stages out there. So, and at every temperature, I keep on solving this Newton's equations of motions and getting different structures. So let's say my first is, remember I told you that pressure and temperatures can be put into a molecular dynamic simulation. So here it is now. So first I solve Newton's equations of motions for a temperature about 900 Kelvin. Now you are wondering, how does a molecule exist at 900 Kelvin? Will not the molecule burst apart? Will not the atoms fragment? Will not the bonds break, the angles break and all out there? Okay, now this temperature, you know, through the kinetic theory of gases, the temperature is actually related to the velocities. So when I'm talking about a molecular dynamic simulation that is run at 900 Kelvin, what it simply means that the velocities of the atoms are commensurating at 900 Kelvin. That means the atoms are moving with a much higher velocity. So at any particular temperature, for example, at room temperature, your atoms have a certain velocity, which is nothing but related to the kinetic energy. So when I heat my molecule, I put that in quotes. You must be wondering, how do I heat my molecule in a computer? The heating of my molecule in a computer is through basically manipulating the velocities. Okay, so when I'm running a molecular dynamic simulations at 900 Kelvin, I'm simply changing the velocities of the atoms. That is, the atoms are moving more vigorously. Okay, they're moving about more vigorously. The vibrations of the atoms are enhanced. They're vibrating from the mean positions very, 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 very quickly. So that is how temperature is basically regulated. Now, why do I need to do this? Why do I need to do a molecular dynamic simulations at a very high temperature? This is because there are many reasons now. One of the reasons why, at low temperatures, molecules get trapped into structures which are not very, very, very meaningful structures. They get trapped in what is called as in molecular dynamic simulations, is called, in parlance, is called as local structures. And I do not want to get molecules trapped into local structures, into meaningless structures. I want the NMR structure. What exactly is happening to the molecule in solution? So in order to prevent my molecules from getting trapped in local structures, I heat them to very high temperatures. That is, I change their velocities and successively I bring down the temperatures very, very gradually and come down to room temperature out here. In this way, what happens is molecules escape from trapped local minima, escape from structures which are meaningless, irrelevant structures, and get me NMR relevant structures, more meaningful structures out here. Now, this is called as simulated annealing. Simulated annealing actually comes from engineering. You know that you know that engineers do this a very, 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 very often for many of their parts. You know what happens when an engineer makes a certain part, you know, say a metal has been fabricated, let's say into the axle of your car. You know that the axle of your car is subjected to a great amount of stress on the road, and especially on Indian roads, and especially on Mumbai roads. I'm sorry. Okay, I'm not in Mumbai, so I can now talk about Mumbai very freely out here. You know how good are Mumbai roads? They're getting better. They're getting better with concretized roads, and we are getting better. But there are places that there are roads are not so good, and there are a lot of potholes. But we're getting this very, very, very soon. Now you know that axle of the car, because of all of these things, that axle can break very easily when subjected to some very uneven forces. When you dump into a pothole and you know what happens to your axle, how much of skip, you know, that axle can break. In order to prevent that axle from breaking very easily, you know what we do? We do all of these parts which are subjected to very high stress and strain, they are annealed. Engineers anneal out them so that they can stand, you know, better stresses and strains very, very readily. So what temperature, what engineers do? They take your metal objects, heat it to a very high temperature to take off all crystal defects and slowly bring down the temperature out here. So as a result, you know, the positions of your atoms in your metal come down to perfect positions in your crystal lattice, and all the stresses and the strains in your metal are actually relieved. That is annealing. And you come down to some, you know, to some structures which can undergo very high strains and very high stresses out here. So this is exactly what I am doing in my molecular modeling program. I'm doing the same thing so that actually I prevent structures from actually getting entrapped in very bad shapes and very bad conformations, in very mess meaningless structures. I can escape from them and get very relevant structures, meaningful structure for my NMR out here. So this is a simulated annealing, and there are a lot of variations of molecular dynamics, from a very simple one to simulated annealing, okay, to simulated annealing things, to okay, to scaling force constants. We have done all of these things in our work. Okay, I won't talk about all of them. Simulated annealing procedures out here. Okay, so now, after solving those things, whether I use a simple molecular dynamic simulations or I use a complicated molecular dynamic simulations out here, in the end, I will get an NMR structure out here. Okay, so now I want you to look at this, at NMR structure. And first, let me say that NMR does not give us a single structure. X-ray crystallography will generate a single structure. All of you must have looked at a PDB structure, must have gone to the protein data bank and download some protein structure for you to visualize sometime or the other. Okay, especially if you're a chemistry student, you must have done this. Okay, go down to the protein data bank and looked at the structure of an enzyme or a protein or a DNA or a lipid or a carbohydrate, and you must have seen some beautiful structures. You always see a single structure. Okay, however, NMR, because we are solving it by molecular dynamics, one reason, we get what is called as an ensemble of structures. As you can see here, there are many structures that have been generated by NMR out here. Okay, so you are only, actually we can generate a multitude of structures. And I'm showing you a few limited structures. How do we select this limitation of structures? There's another protocol about how to select limited structures in NMR. So here are some 5 or 6 structures that have been extracted from my MD program. Okay, now you begin to see that, okay, there are structures which are superimposed upon each other. So let's look at this part of my structure. Okay, this part of my structure tells you that in this part of my molecule, actually this part of my molecule actually has not a unique structure, but actually there are so many structures that this part of my molecule can adopt. Let's look at this part of my molecule. As I told you, there are 5 structures out here, and all the 5 structures out there are superimposable out here. So you see the structure here for my molecule is very sharply defined. Okay, I know quite exactly and with a great degree of certainty what is this structure. Let's look at this part, the end of my structure. This is the end term, this is the C terminal of my protein. Again, you see at the C terminal of my protein, the structure is not uniquely defined, but there is a lot of motion in my structure. Now, why does this happen? Some parts of my structure are very explicitly defined, very sharply defined. Some parts of my structure are very loosely defined, and the looseness can be to a very great degree. And look, the looseness here, the looseness is a little more tight. The looseness here is very high. The looseness here is very high. So why is this, that some parts of my structure are very explicitly, sharply defined, while some parts of my structure are not explicitly defined? There are 2 reasons. One reason could be that in this part of my structure, there is a huge amount of intrinsic dynamics or intrinsic motion, that this part of my structure is very labile in solution, having a lot of flip-flop motions, and all the atoms here have a lot of motions and an ability to move about. So this is intrinsic flexibility in my structure. So intrinsic flexibility in my structure could actually give me the reason why this part of my molecule is not sharply defined. The second reason why many parts of my structure are not sharply defined, I do not have a single structure, is because the information could not be very sharply extracted. As I told you, NMR has only a small fraction of the information. Remember, right in the beginning, I told you that NMR extra. It's only 25% of the degrees of freedom. So you see the information here, the NOEs or the dihedral angles or the dipolar couplings or the hydrogen bonding could not be very explicitly extracted for this part of my structure. And therefore, I have an intrinsic disorder. This intrinsic disorder can stem from two things: NMR data, which has not been very sharply defined, not properly recorded or not properly extracted. And second, because of intrinsic motion out here. So this is what I want you to appreciate as a take home lesson. When we look at a structure that has been defined by X-ray, we have sharply defined structures. Of course, it all depends upon the resolution. It also depends sometimes, even in solid states, there are parts of the molecules which are in motion. Okay, even sometimes in X-ray structures, you will see some flip-flop. Okay, that tells you that the temperature factors are very high and there is motion of atoms even in the solid state. So don't be surprised that atoms in molecules are moving about only in solution. Even in solid state, sometimes there is quite a bit of flexibility, and as a result, even X-ray cannot record the structure very, very exactly. But that is for a small fraction of the molecule or a small fraction of the part of the molecule. But in NMR, you can see quite a bit of dynamical behavior for many reasons out here. Now, so if I want a single structure from it, there are techniques in molecular modeling which can help me to take a sort of an average structure. So this is the average structure from this ensemble of structure. What is an ensemble? An ensemble is a collection of structures that my molecular dynamic simulation has built. And from that ensemble of structures, I can get a single structure out here. Okay, so motion in NMR can be because of through motion, intrinsic flexibility, intrinsic dynamics, or it can be because my NMR has been poorly resolved and I cannot extract accurate information out here. Okay, as I said, that there are a lot of other multitude of ways in order to extract information, in order to do molecular dynamic simulation. There is torsion angle dynamics. Okay, what is torsion angle dynamics different from molecular dynamic simulation? We actually see dynamics around torsion angles. Okay, MD using torsion angles instead of Cartesian coordinates at the degrees of freedom out here. Then I said there is distance geometry, and I don't think I want to go ahead with distance geometry. There's lots of mathematics and I don't want to go into this mathematics and bore you all out here. Okay, distance geometry can also help us to use NMR information in order to build structure out here. Okay, so after we build a structure, we need to do a validation. Okay, and one way of doing a validation is basically to look at your plot. When you build a structure, you can plot what is called as a Ramachandran plot. Okay, so you know that, for example, for a protein at the backbone, as I told you earlier, you have these two dihedral angles, which are called as the phi and the psi dihedral angle. So after I build my NMR structure, okay, I can look at the phi psi angles of every amino acid and I can plot the phi psi angles out here. Okay, so this is a plot of the phi psi angles basically of my NMR structure. So all these black dots are the phi psi angles of particular amino acids in my NMR structure of my protein, which has been solved by NMR out here. And you know that the Ramachandran plot tells us that there are only certain structures which are allowed. I hope you all have learned something about the Ramachandran plot. What the Ramachandran plot is? The Ramachandran was one of the brilliant, structural chemist in his time in the 1960s out here. Okay, he worked for some time in Madras at Chennai, and then he was at the Institute of Science, Bangalore out here. He was the first person to show, okay, the relationship between allowed protein structures, which protein structures are allowed and which protein structures are disallowed as a deal. And that is called the Ramachandran plot. Okay, so there are certain regions which are disallowed, certain regions which are allowed out here. As you can see, okay, the pink regions are all allowed protein structures. Okay, all allowed. These protein structures are allowed. That means these are certain structures which proteins can adopt. This white region tells us that here are protein structures which are totally disallowed. That means not all phi psi angles proteins can adopt all the range of phi psi angles. For example, a protein cannot take a phi angle of 135. Okay, cannot take a look at this point in space. In the Ramachandran plot, look at this plot. This point refers to a phi angle of 135 and a psi angle of 135. They cannot be a protein structures whose phi angle is 135 and whose psi angle is 135. This is a disallowed structure. There is no protein in the world with such a combination of phi psi values, because when I put this phi and psi angles in my protein structures, the atoms will clash and bump into each other. The side chain atoms will clash into the backbone atoms, or the side chain atoms may clash into each other. So structures are disallowed. Okay. Or, for example, you cannot have a structure where the phi angle is about 25 degrees and the psi angle is minus 135. This point, there is no protein structure with the phi angle of about 25 degrees and a psi angle of about minus 100. It is not possible to have such a structure out here. So what Ramachandran showed, that only certain protein structures can be adopted. Proteins can only take certain amount of structures. There are huge number of structures which are disallowed. And this pink region shows that all permissible protein structures, protein peptide structures, can adopt only this thing. And now you begin to see that my structure has all its phi psi angles in the allowed region. But sadly to say, there is this one angle of glutamine 154, which actually has a phi psi angle which is not permissible. And there is another amino acid in my protein, at proline at position 155 in my sequence, whose phi psi angles is not in the Ramachandran allowed region. So there is something little wrong in my NMR structures that have been simulated out here. So validation shows me that there is some problem. Two of my amino acid angles have not been correctly determined, have not been correctly. So here's another. There's another glutamate. Okay, it's the same one. Any other? Okay. So what I need to do is somehow do corrections. And there are ways of correcting for prop. What are these called? These are improperly folded parts of my protein. So I have simulated structures where glutamine 154 and proline at 155 have not been properly folded. They are not adopting the correct conformation to give me nice low energy structures out there. So I need to do a little bit of refinement and all, and I won't talk about all of that, but there are ways of correcting for this, and so that all the amino acids in my protein fall into the allowed Ramachandran region out here. Okay, so this is corrections, how needs to be done. I won't talk about out here, but there is correction. Now, all that I want to say is the Ramachandran plot is very important. That tells me whether I have properly simulated structures or there are some errors in my structure which need to be recorrected by other techniques out here. Okay, so with this, I think I should finish off with my NMR lecture. Thank you very much for you're listening to me. And I forgot to thank the organizers, Dr. Premlatar, and the team at, and Dr. Krishna Iyer and the team at the pharmacy department, pharmaceutical chemistry department of Bombay College of Pharmacy, all of you all, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to talk on this FDP. So thank you very much. I hope I have done my best to tell you a little bit about how structures are generated from NMR. I know Professor Hosur did a wonderful talk on this out here. He's the genius. Okay, he is the genius in NMR. He has devised many new techniques, novel techniques. He has published some wonderful papers, some very high impact factor papers. He is a genius. But I thought I'll take you a little bit of what he doesn't do and what Coutinho does. So I thought how you can take NMR data and solve stuff. I do not know if he presented this out here, but you got a better understanding of how to use NMR data and to solve for NMR structures out here. Okay, so with this, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Evans Coutinho. It was indeed an excellent delivery, full of enthusiasm, the same way that we have witnessed in Bombay College of Pharmacy.
Thank you
so much for your enlightening and intriguing speech. By any measure, sir, you are a very effective speaker and an educator.
Your presentation
definitely drew the participants' attention for full 2 hours, I can say. And I'm sure that it has rekindled an enthusiasm for enhancing their research in MD simulations using the NMR data. Let me just summarize with what Professor Coutinho has presented. He took us with the basics of the NMR in terms of explaining the various degrees of freedom and how the techniques of X-ray crystallography, the neutron diffraction data, and the NMR can help us in understanding the exact positions of the hydrogens or the atoms in a given structure. What was explicitly explained to us by Professor Coutinho was in terms of the NMR data, in terms of modeling, wherein he explained the restraints, various restraints that are used in building a 3D model with respect to the coupling constants, the nuclear Oberhauser effect, the dipolar couplings, the chemical shifts, the hydrogen bonding, and finally the chirality. Sir took us to a number of complicated equations, I can say, wherein he explained to us with respect to the Newton's equations of motions with respect to time, the Taylor's expansion with respect to the use of acceleration, and how the linear equation Wurlitt-Leapfrog can help us actually for the MD simulations. So, once again, thank you, Professor Coutinho. And with your permission, can I take a few questions which are there from the participants?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So we have the question. I think this probably is from Elvis, is what I think, that while studying the proteins in the natural environment, will there be any effect of other adjacent proteins present in respective sample on the NMR data?
Definitely, because any other thing that is going to be present in my environment, for example, let's take the first environment variable, that is the solvent atoms. Solvent atoms also influence the structure. Okay, so the solvent atoms, through their electrostatics, through their viscosity, through all these parameters that are there in of the solvent, okay, is going to influence my structure. For example, if I have a very viscous solution, then very obviously I'm going to have a limited amount of tumbling. I'm going to have a very restricted motion, just like in the solid. Okay, you know that motions are very restricted because the atoms are frozen in space. You have this crystal packing forces and this lattice forces. We do not allow your atoms to move in space. So likewise, solvent atoms, okay, by virtue of their properties, will influence the structure. So likewise, if you have another protein atom, if you have another protein molecule, then that protein molecule is going to influence how this other molecule is going to take on a particular shape and a particular conformation. So all of these environmental variables will influence the structure of my molecule. Even, for example, you will add like salts. The salts are going to have an effect on how my conformation is going to be this out there. Let's say you take sodium chloride. Okay, then the sodium atom normally starts to associate with my negative carboxylate atoms out here. So you begin to neutralize, your salt begins to neutralize basically the Coulombic interactions out here, and that changes basically the conformation out here. So yes, Elvis or whoever asked that question, yes, your environment is going to seriously change the structure of the molecule which is of interest to you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. We have another question from Girish Gurbani, and he is asking that, sir, while studying the proteins, we have another question from Mahesh, who asks, like, nowadays we can see many protein structures are resolved by cryo EM. So which protein structure, cryo EM, NMR, X-ray, that will give me the realistic true picture of protein to start my modeling study?
Okay, cryo EM is used used at a very low temperature. Okay, so what will cryo EM basically do is you go down at a very low temperature, so you freeze the structure at a very particular point in time. So there are several advantages with cryo EM. For example, protein structures which cannot be solved at room temperatures because of many reasons. Okay, many reasons, because of aggregation, because of motions, because of a lot of things out here. You can use cryo EM to basically solve the structures out here. But cryo EM has a difficulty in one thing, that getting explicit positions of atom. Okay, cryo EM will get you basically a grosh picture out here. You know, you cannot actually explicitly define the positions of the atoms in space. You get a grosh overall picture or an overall fold of that molecule. What we want is an explicit, you know, coordinates of each and every atom in space. That is basically from X-ray to some extent with NMR supplemented with molecular dynamic simulations, you can actually get these sort of things. So cryo EM is a very good technique, can be used when you have a lot of problems. Okay. Large molecules can nicely be solved by cryo EM. The problem with large molecules with NMR is that you have a problem. There is a limit to the size of the atoms which you can solve by NMR. I forgot to say that. Unlike X-ray, there is no limit to the size of the atom, to the size of the molecule that you can solve by X-ray crystallography. But in NMR, there is a limit. Why? There is an upper limit to the size of the molecule by NMR. People are pushing that upper limit today out there. It is because when we have very large molecules, you tend to have aggregation, you tend to have very broad lines, and that basically then all the information is lost out there. So I'm not aware of today where is the upper limit for solving structures by NMR. People have used the experiment called as TROSI, okay, by Wutrich. Wutrich has used TROSI to push the upper limit of structures that can be solved by NMR. But okay, so cryo TM is useful, but to the best of my knowledge, you get a grosh and an overall fold and not an explicit, you know, coordinates of the atoms out here. Okay, so those which cannot be solved by other techniques, cryo TM is giving us some very useful useful information. But remember that you have to go to very low temperatures in order to solve it by cryo TM. I do not know if I should say that is a disadvantage or really an advantage in going down to very low temperatures. Okay, any other question?
Okay, yes, sir. We have one question from Dr. Bandhu, and he's asking that Desmond module of Schrodinger's, can it possible to change temperature for ND simulation study, whether it affects the results of the study?
Yes, so every molecular dynamics program, whether you're using it through AMBER, through GROMOS, or whether you're using Schrodinger molecular dynamics simulation, you have the ability to change the temperature and the pressure. Okay, very fundamental. Now, you can do basically different types of dynamics, okay, ensemble, micro ensemble, canonical, all of those sort of things where you freeze the temperatures, you freeze the pressures, you hold temperature constant, pressures variables. You have to decide on what sort of ensemble dynamics you're actually trying to do, canonical, micro canonical, etc., or the grand ensemble dynamics out here. But in effect, yes, temperature and pressures are definitely available for you to change and to switch. And this will definitely affect the structure. As I told you, at 900 Kelvin, I basically begin to see a lot of motion. So you'll see a lot of flexibility, you'll see a lot of floppiness in your molecule if you do your molecular dynamic simulations at 900K. Remember, I showed you one structure where you saw some parts of the molecule which were not explicitly defined. At 900K, you'll see most of your atoms are not very clear and not very explicitly defined because the motions, the velocity of the atoms are very high. So you'll see huge amount of motions. So your structures become very fuzzy at 900 Kelvin. So any temperature, remember, has an effect on the structure through the motion of the atoms out here. Okay, so what we really want is a structure at 300 Kelvin or at room temperature out here. So it is best to simulate structures at 1 bar, 1 atmosphere, and 300 Kelvin. Okay, so normally pressure is always kept at 1 bar, and temperatures can be changed in order to overcome basically your your problems with being with structures being caught into unrealistic low energy minima. That is why we elevate the temperature. But your answer is yes, temperatures and pressures can be modified in any molecular dynamics simulations, and definitely can be done in Desmond. And temperatures and pressures have an effect on that, on the structure that you are going to simulate out. So keep that in mind.
Yes, sir. Yes, I just hope that answers the query of Dr. Bandhu. We have another question from Dr. Sagar Patel. He's asking that given a choice between NMR resolved structure modified by molecular modeling and a model developed by a homology modeling using a parent structure resolved by X-ray crystallography and refined by modeling, which is a better choice?
So you have two things on one hand. Do I want to generate experimental structures or do I want to generate theoretical structures? So let's look at theoretical structure, which one method is basically homology modeling, okay? Homology modeling using some parent structures. If your target protein, whose structure you want to determine, if it has a very close homology to your reference protein, if your homology is greater than 70%, then you can be sure that you have a very reasonable structure. You have a very reasonable structure, that your structure for the target is very accurately and reasonably determined. However, when your target and your reference deviate to a very large extent, when the identity goes below 70, 60, 50, 40, and 30, the lower limit, then the reliability of the structures and the accuracy of the structures begin to decrease. Okay. So this said, let's say that Sagar, that you have a protein whose target protein whose reference you know and very closely related, then go ahead and do homology modeling, because the time and the cost for doing homology modeling, you can do homology modeling in a matter of a day or less than a day. All depends upon what is the reference and where are you submitting it to and how quickly you get the answers, or whether you are doing it at your own workstation out here. Within a day you can get. NMR requires a lot of time and effort. Huge amount. It's costly. NMR is costly. Especially if it's a protein, you need to have a labeled sample. I need to label all my carbon atoms in my backbone with 13C. Remember, said that I need chemical shift information, and this chemical shift information is for my 13C. You know that a natural protein has a less than 0.1% of 13C abundance, yeah? Very small abundance. In order to increase the abundance of this, I need to label my protein with 13C, and I also need to label my nitrogen atoms with 15N. So when I basically am doing a protein expression through molecular biology, I grow my bug in glucose-rich medium, and in a 15 and in an ammonium chloride rich medium, so that all my backbone atoms, my carbon atoms and my nitrogen atoms are actually labeled by 13C and 15N in order to record this NMR. Okay, so that's a very costly experiment. You need expertise in molecular biology. You need expertise in cloning and expressions and purifications. You need to do this out here. Okay, so all these need. Where normally, okay, there's another problem with molecular biology when you're doing cloning and expression. Many times after cloning and expression and you extract a protein, it gives you a very unnatural fold. And you have to unfold and refold your protein using all this urea and guanidine chloride, you know, to unfold and refold. That's a big torture. If ever after molecular biology, your protein has folded into a very unnatural state, it has misfolded, hell. Sorry to use that word. You have to use a lot of techniques to refold it back again. So NMR is not easy. It's time consuming. It is costly. The NMR time to recording all of these experiments is huge. Is huge. It's a costly experiment. To record 2D NMR, 3D NMR, and 4D NMR for all of these things is a huge amount of time and cost. So NMR thing is yes. You get very relevant biological information. You get dynamic behavior, which cannot be obtained by any other technique other than molecular dynamic simulations. Okay, you get biologically. So there are advantages on both the sides. But for quick information, nothing like homology modeling. And I would go for homology modeling to get you a first hand and a preview of what my structure looks like. Yes, go ahead and do molecular modeling over this. If you don't have the resources, if you don't have the time, go and do molecular modeling with all its caveats. As I said, that it depends upon homology. 60 to 70% homology to my reference proteins, you are in a nice shape. You have meaningful structures which you can use in drug design and drug development and drug discovery. Below that, you will develop structures, but you have to be wary if you are using this in drug design and in drug discovery. Structures which are built with an identity of below 50 to 40%, don't use it for drug design, for drug discovery. You can only get information about the topology or the fold of the molecule if your homology goes down to below 40 or 50%. Such structures people have used in drug design and drug discovery, but they are on the wrong path. Okay, you can use it for drug design and discovery to discover new drugs and make new molecules and discover new ligands. Only if your identity with your reference structures is about 70 to 80%, then you have very accurate structures which can be used in drug design and discovery.
Yes, sir. So there's one more question from Dhruvanshi, sir. And sir is asking that we can use this technique for herbal photochemical identification in extract, which contain many photochemical in extracts. I think phytochemical probably.
See, if you are going to take the structure of an extract which has so many components inside it, then it's going to be a problem. Okay, then it's really going to be a problem how to determine the structure this out here, because first of all your NMR is going to be so complicated. Okay, it's going to be an overlap of the structures of so many components in your extract that trying to decipher anything from your NMR experiment, chemical shifts and coupling constants and dipolar couplings, becomes impossible. So we need NMR data of pure single components, okay? Whether it's of a protein or a small molecule or of extracts, it needs to be the NMR data of a pure single component out here. Only then you can use this sort of information in order to develop the structure. So for mixtures and all, the answer is no. The answer is no. But if your intention is to how to use mixtures to use NMR in drug design, then there is a technique, NMR by SAR, which was developed by Abbott in USA, the group, the pharmaceutical company, which have actually used mixtures in order to find out which component in that mixture can actually binds tightly to your target. There is a technique called NMR by SAR, which can use mixtures in order to get information about which of those molecules are biologically active and which are inactive out here. But no, you cannot use NMR data or mixtures in order to solve for structures.
Before I take another question, sir, can you just stop the slide share so that we'll be able to see you?
Oh, you want to see me? Oh.
Yes, sir, because there are many of your students who are now as a faculty and have complimented you. So before I take up another question.
I'm not in Mumbai, so I'm not looking very handsome here.
No, sir.
Okay, want to see me? Yeah, I'm not in Mumbai actually. Okay, can you see me?
Yes, sir, very much. So nice to see you, sir.
Thank you.
So now Anish is asking one question, which is actually, I think, in general, not with respect to the NMR per se. He is asking, what would be your advice to young students with a budding career in research?
Oh, okay. So what path you want to take let's look at the technology platforms for drug discovery and drug discovery. And I'm talking about things which I am very familiar with. Okay. So I think all of you in chemistry should develop skills in synthesis. This is very important to do skills in synthesis, learn how to synthesize molecules. Okay, learn the different methods of isolation and purification of molecules. Learn about structure determination, how to determine the structures of molecules. That is important. And then learn biology, how to do screening. Okay, whether it is inhibition of an enzyme or whatever it is, or it is any biological assay, whether you are testing against cells or against bacteria, gather these skills. These are very, very important. So I would advise all you young medicinal chemists out here who are doing your PhD, keep these skill sets. I'm not deterring from the other skill sets like pharmacokinetics. It's very important. Great. Do also metabolism. It is great. Now, when you come down to chemistry, synthesis, and you know, doing all of these things, you have a lot of competition. The MSc and the PhD people in chemistry compete with us. And many times the pharmaceutical company says that we'll take the MSc and the PhD students because they are better than you in synthesis out here. To some extent, I believe in them, not 100% out here. But when it comes down to the other facets of medicinal chemistry, like pharmacokinetics and metabolism, you are very unique. You are very unique. Okay, even analysis, for example, if you tone your skills in analysis, you have competition from the MSc in analytical chemistry and the PhD in analytical chemistry. And then again, there again, I see that pharma companies tend to differentiate people in the pharmacy section with these skill sets. They take the chemistry people, you know, the analytical people, and they say they are better than this. I don't want to get into those arguments and that controversies out here. But coming down to kinetics and metabolism, you are unique. You are very unique. Even coming down to formulation skill sets, you are very unique because there is nobody who does all of these things. Now, pharmacology and biological testing, you have competition with your M.Pharm students who do biology. But if you are interested in chemistry and pure chemistry like synthesis, I would say do synthesis, learn how to handle instruments in order for you to do purification, learn some chromatographic techniques, learn NMR, okay, learn NMR, how to record an NMR, how to interpret an NMR, and learn biology, learn how to do screening, how to do testing, and then if possible, and if your institute allows you, do molecular modeling. Learn about how to build structures with molecular modeling if your guide or if your institute can help you. So if you add all of these things, I think you are then in a very enviable positions out here. So the best positions are basically people who have good skill sets in pharmacokinetics, good skill sets in metabolism, and then with medicinal chemistry, having knowledge about both sides, the experimental and the computational aspects out here. Now, this is not to deter those of you who are only doing computational chemistry, not saying that you won't find a job, but looking at the scenario today in India, yes, it's slightly difficult for computational chemists to get a job in their field and this out here. And if I sadly would say that, I think it is only now in the academics to become a teacher and do that. I know, because there are not many drug discovery, drug design companies in India that actually take people with such skill sets. I know many people have been retrenched and lost the jobs with being only computational chemists. And even US is not being given too many of the programs to Indian companies in order to do modeling. I know some of my students who used to do a lot of projects for companies in the US, today they're saying that is dying down. US is not, the companies in US are not giving their projects to Indian organizations, you know, CRO organizations, CRO organizations to do actually drug discovery and all. So very sad to say that people with pure computation may have a little difficulty. Okay, so one way into overcome this problem is try to do a postdoc abroad. I know that is also difficult nowadays with this COVID pandemic is becoming still difficult, and try to increase your expertise as much as possible and get as wide a domain as possible to increase your chances of, you know, your work prospects after your program. I hope I've answered that, Anish.
Yes, surely, sir, you have. Now, let me read some of the compliments, sir. There are many, but I'll just mention a few. We have with us Dr. Meena Kanyalkar, and she has said that an excellent lecture and completely nostalgic experience for me. Really very informative lecture, and thank you, sir. Then
Let me pause here. Meena, you remember, this is all your work, all your PhD work.
So, with your permission, Dr. Kanyalkar would like to speak something. Is it possible?
Yes. Yes.
Yes, Dr. Kanyalkar, you can unmute and speak, please.
Meena, that was all your work, all your PhD work.
Can we unmute her?
She has the access to mic, but I'm not sure she's been able to do it.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I think by the time she tries, yeah, has she?
Dr. Shirsat, actually we are running behind time. It's 11:19.
Okay, fine. Then, yes, then I think I will just mention the names. We have Dr. Nizamuddin, who is thanking for helping in determination of the Ramchandra plot. Then we have Archana Guzar, who is also thanking you, sir. And we have Kamlesh Soni also, and many others, sir, Vijay Patil and all, you can see in the chat box. So thank you so much, sir, once again for this very, very insightful presentation, sir. And over to the organizers.
Thank you, Dr. Shirsat, for chairing this session. And thank you very, very much, Professor Coutinho, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot for accepting our request and being here as a part of FDP, as a resource person. Without your guidance, anyway, this program wouldn't have happened. So thank you very, very much. I take pleasure to, you know, felicitate you with a green token. We have our research associate, Mr. Anish Gomatam. Sir, I would request you to please keep your camera on, if you don't mind. May I request, sir, to please keep your camera on? And I would also request Anish to just play a video so that sir will have a look at it. Anish? Is there a lag? Dr. Shirsat, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, we can.
I think there's a lag here.
Yeah, there's a lag.
Okay, Dr. Elvis, could you please help us?
Yes, I'm just looking at it. Just a minute.
Yeah.
I think the video played and it went back. Girish, can you just take it to the previous slide?
Oh, we did not notice that.
Yeah, it's showing the certificate slide actually.
Is it?
Yeah, now I think you can play the video. No sound.
Is that there? Somehow there is a lag.
Yeah, the video is seen, but audio is not heard.
I think there's a lag from my side also. I'm unable to see even the slide moving.
Now it's the certificate slide.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's the certificate slide.
Thank you. I think there's a lag from my side also. So, sir, we wish to even appreciate you with the e-token of, certificate. So please accept on behalf of organizing committee this e-certificate, and we will soon share